Friends, in the sixth module of the history of Indian sculpture, we are going to continue with Shunga sculpture, but now our focus will be on Sanchi. This is the part of our PG course in Visual Arts and Aesthetics, and I am Deepak Karnal from Faculty of Fine Arts, MS University of Baroda. In this module, the history and important sources of Satavahana dynasty will be introduced, after which Sanchi monuments and sculptures will be analyzed. Since Sanchi was a center of art with both Bharut, that is Shunga, and Amaravati, Satavahana influences, it becomes important to understand different sources from which we get information about the dynasty and its art. Numismatics, that is study of coins, epigraphy, inscriptions, sculptures, and textual sources. Sanchi art is then compared with Bharut art and Amaravati to understand how the influence of both the places can be seen in Sanchi. Among textual sources which talk about Satavahana dynasty, the most significant ones are Puranas, but there is some difference in the names and chronology of rulers mentioned. All of them do not exactly match. The Royal Portrait Gallery called Devakula and references from coins and inscriptions also give us new details. Scholars have interpreted these evidences differently. Gatha Saptashati, a text attributed to the Satavahana king Hala, is a unique source to understand the life of common people of that time. Parts of Bharut, Sanchi and Amaravati may have been contemporary to each other, and they are seen to influence each other. Maybe there was a movement of artists from one region to another. Also, ivory carving and wood carving traditions have been speculated as per existing. We also find inscriptions in support for this argument. Sanchi sculptures can be seen as a language in art which is evolving and as a glimpse of life that time. The main content of Sanchi sculpture, like some part of Sanchi, seems to have been executed under the dominion of Satavahana kings. Thus, history of Satavahana dynasty must be understood to understand the impact and changes in the art of Sanchi. Bharut art has been entirely under the reign of Shungas. In comparison, Sanchi evolved during Shungas as well as Satavahanas. The Satavahana dynasty rose in the Deccan region on the Indian subcontinent. The kings of this dynasty have been identified as Andhras by the Puranas. Matsya and Brahmanda Purana claim a list of 30 kings who ruled over 460 years. Vayu Purana claims 17 kings who ruled over 300 years. Coins in India have been found from pre-Mauryan period, and these are mostly Panchmark coins. From Mauryan period onwards, coins and inscriptions become important sources of history. Study of coins is called numismatics, and study of inscriptions is called epigraphy, as we mentioned above. Coins and inscriptions from Satavahana period speak about kings who are not mentioned in Puranic lists. Scholars are divided over the issue of dating and whether they came to power first in Eastern or Western Deccan. Some claim the beginning of their rule at 271 BCE, and others give the date to 30 BCE. Early Satavahana coins have discovered from Kotalingala and Sangareddy in Karimnagar district of Andhra Pradesh. Eventually, Satavahana kings covered most of Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, and parts of Saurashtra, Karnataka, and Madhya Pradesh. Pliny the Elder, who was a Roman philosopher and author and army commander, mentions Andhra country as having 30 walled towns, and that the state had 1 lakh infantry, 2,000 cavalry, and 1,000 elephants. Pliny also refers to Indica in his work. Indica was written by the Greek ethnographer and explorer who probably visited the court of Mauryan king Chandragupta I. For a detailed discussion on chronology and names of the Satavahana kings, refer to Ajay Mitra Shastri's paper on this subject. Many important trade centers were part of the region under Satavahana, including Ter, the ancient name of it was Tagara, Paithan, the ancient name was Pratishthana, Bokardan, ancient name was Bhogavardhana. There was a conflict over the control of port towns like Kalyan, Suruparaka, the present-day Sopara near Bombay, and Bhrugukaccha, which is the present-day Bharuch, which were important due to trade. There are many inscriptions related to Satavahana king found from various places. An inscription at Nasik dated to 18th year of Gautamiputra's reign records a grant to Buddhist monks. Another inscription written in Prakrit describes Gautamiputra Shatakarni as Eka Brahmana, a peerless Brahmana, and Khatiya Dapamana Madanasa, one who destroyed the haughtiness and pride of the Kshatriyas. There is enough reason to believe that the Satavahanas, who were in all probability, were not Brahmins, but are trying to claim that status continuously by performing various sacrifices and in inscriptions. Naneghat is another place with many inscriptions, and that seems to have been the royal portrait gallery of the kings. It is called a Devakula. There are 8 sculptures, almost life size, found in a cave at Naneghat. They are in a very bad condition and only the feet are visible today. Fortunately, the inscriptions on top of each one of them can still be read, without which it would have been impossible to identify these sculptures. The 8 inscriptions read, the illustrious king Rayasi Simuka Satavahana, who was considered to be the founder of Satavahana dynasty. Second and third, Queen Sirimato Devi Nayanika or Naganika, and the illustrious king Rano Satakani, that is Satakarni. 4, Prince Kumara Bhayala. Fifth, the name is lost, we can't read it. Sixth, Maharathi Tranakariya. Seventh is Prince, that is Kumara Hakusri. Eighth is Prince Kumara Satavahana. In the inscriptions of Naganika in Naneghat, there are references to performance of Vedic sacrifices by Satakarni first. An inscription at a place called Hathi Gumpha at Udaygiri near Bhuvaneshwar in Odisha was inscribed by Kharavela, the king of Kalinga from Chedi dynasty, who is contemporaneous to Satavahana. It is a long inscription and line 4 reads, "And in the second year, he, disregarding Satakarni, patched to the western region an army strong in cavalry, elephants, infantry, nara, and chariots, that is Ratha, and by that army, having reached the Kannabenna, he threw the city of the Mushika into consternation. Thus, King Kharavela claims to have defeated Satakarni. This inscription will be discussed again in the next module with reference to a sculpture in Bhaja Caves. Another source from Satavahana period is a text called Gatha Satyasai, a collection of 700 poems in Maharashtri Prakrit, Prakrit dialect, which are mostly erotic in nature. Though the text is attributed to Hala, Satavahana king, as we mentioned earlier, though poems do not seem to be by a single author, and many may have been part of the folklore or authored by women. A long lost text called Brihat Katha was written in Paishachi, which is again another kind of Prakrit, by Gunadhya, who seemed to have flourished under the Satavahanas. Stories from the lost text are mentioned in the later period text called Katha Sarit Sagara, which is authored by Somadeva, and Brihat Katha Manjari, which is authored by Kshemindra. Now we will come to the actual monuments, that is the Sanchi Stupa. Early Brahmi inscriptions found from this site refer to Sanchi as Kakavana or Kakanaya. This site is not associated with particular event in Buddha's life, but was located near Vidisha, a very important city on trade route. Extensive remains have been found from the site of Sanchi, which was a monastic complex close to ancient Vidisha. When the site was discovered, it was in a very bad state and full of only debris of stones. The present structure has been reconstructed from scratch. Stupa II, perhaps the oldest one out of these, has reliquaries with inscriptions which claim that the bone relief found belong to the great Buddhist teacher and saints that lived during Maurya times and even participated in the third Buddhist council, which is known as Sangiti. The stupa does not belong to Mauryan times and has been dated on paleographic and stylistic basis by different scholars at different dates. Though there is considerable debate on the dates, some scholars have placed the monuments to 150 BCE on paleographic basis. Marshall has placed it to 75 BCE to 20 BCE because the name of King Satakarni is mentioned in the inscription and inscription that has been dated. Vedika of this stupa looks like an imitation of one made in wood. It is probably there was a tradition of sculpting in wood prior to stone, which is now lost to us. Motifs sculpted on the pillar of this stupa include an Ashokan type pillar with lion capital and a chakra on top, a peepal tree with garlands and many Buddhist motifs. Stupa III also has relics which, according to inscriptions, belong to the famous monks Mahamoggallana and Sariputta. Traces of red paint and plaster show that the stupas may have originally been covered with red paint. Interiors and exteriors of the railings of the stupa are carved. The four gateways of the main stupa were probably erected under the dominion of Satavahanas. Like Bharut, Sanchi too has many inscriptions which tell us about the donors and peoples of that time. For example, one inscription mentions Balamitra, who was the pupil of Ayachuda, as the donor of a pillar of western gateway. Another donor is mentioned as Nagapiya, a banker of Achavada mentioned by Ananda, who was the royal architect of King Satakarni. It has been translated as gift of Ananda, the son of Vasithi, that is Vashishti, the foreman of the artisans, Aveshanin. The king is probably Satakarni, second of Satavahana dynasty, who ruled around 4th century BCE. An Ashokan inscription has also been discovered at Shatadhara in Sanchi complex. Inscriptions tell us that many of these donors were from Malwa region, and while few were from distant places like Magadha in Bihar, Paithan, known as Pratishthana in ancient times, and Bhokardhan, known as Bhogavardhana, most of them were lay people, the worshippers, monks and nuns. It may be mentioned that the intricate carvings of this stupa resemble very closely ivory carvings of Begram, which belong to the Satavahana period. Their style too can be compared, and similarities can be traced. In fact, An inscription on the southern gateway mentions that some of the carvings in stone were done by the ivory carvers who belong to the nearby town of Vidisha. In the art of this stupa, like Bharut, we do not find human representation of Buddha. So an empty throne, the footprints or Bodhi tree are used to symbolize Buddha. Depictions include Buddha giving his first sermon in a deer park at Sarnath near Varanasi and thus turning the wheel of Dharma, the Dharma Chakra, a king in a chariot with two horses. Ashoka's visit to the Buddhist shrine, Indra and other gods worshipping the hair of Buddha in the 33rd heaven, the story of Naga Muchalinda, in which the Naga protects Buddha from storm and rains, offering of alms, bowl of two merchants called Trapusha and Bhallika. Swastika, who was a grass cutter, seems to have offered Buddha a bundle of grass, and Sujata, the daughter of the chieftain of Uruvela, offered rice and milk to Buddha when he was totally emaciated due to the meditation. Both these incidents have been depicted. Then there is Ashoka's visit to the stupa of Ramagrama, Gajalakshmi, birth of Buddha, Lion Pillar capital. The departure of Buddha, Chaddanta Jataka, dispute over Buddha's relics. This was carved by ivory carvers of Vidisha according to that inscription. Various miracles performed by Buddha at the hermitage of Kashyapa and many Shalabandikas. An Ashokan pillar has also been found at Sanchi. The stump of this pillar is still in situ, that is on site, and the lion capital is in the site museum. The probable date of setting up this pillar has been suggested as 254 BCE. An inscription has been recovered from the fragment of this pillar found from the site, which is in a damaged condition but has been read as the split up Sangha, both of monks and nuns, has been made one united whole. As long as my sons and great grandsons shall rule, the moon and the sun shall shine. The monk or nun who create a division in the Sangha shall be made to put on white robes and to stay out of the Sangha residence. For what is my desire? That the Sangha as a united body may long endure. Sanchi remains an important place of worship till the Gupta period, and one of the earliest Brahmanical temples has been found from Sanchi. The monasteries were probably active even till 11th-12th century. Sanchi, Bharut and Amravati, all the three sites belong to the same period. The idiom that develops at these three sites immensely contribute to the language of Indian sculpture. With these three sites, for the first time, an Indian sculptural language emerges. The crystallization of Buddhist symbols seem to have taken place at Sanchi. In the sculptures of Bharut, there is a kind of inconsistency in the symbols. The artists in Bharut are trying some new possibilities. For example, in the depiction of the story of Jetavana, Buddha is depicted as Gandhakuti, that is, Buddha's dwelling in the Jetavana. So the artists make an attempt at giving alternatives to the presence of Buddha in those images. In Sanchi, however, a codified symbolism is used to depict Buddha. Buddha's footprints, Bodhi Vriksha, that is the tree, Dharma Chakra, Triratna, it stands for Buddha, Sangha and Dhamma. and other symbols become codified. Even allied symbols like Shalabhanjikas become codified. It can be said that a beginning of iconography can be seen at Sanchi. Toran has become extremely popular. We have already observed that most probably ivory carvers are attempting to make stone sculpture for the first time, and there is an inscription which supports this. The treatment of stone at Sanchi is very different. The sculptures are carved quite intricately. A parallel can be drawn here. As has been mentioned in the module on ivories, with early Christian sculpture, early crosses and Christian sculptures, which were derived from wood carvings of Viking ships and ivory carvings. It may be speculated here that the artists in ancient India probably belonged to the Shudra community. They could definitely not belong to the other three higher castes. Thus, they probably did not have theoretical information and they were skilled in the technique of carving only. They must not therefore have been familiar with text and treatises. So the person guiding the artist was not familiar with the technique and the requirements of the sculpting, while the artist was not familiar with the textual references. In later period, an intermediary seems to have taken the role of bridging the gap, and this was the Navakarmika. Navakarmika may have been played the role of conveying the requirements of the pattern and narration and iconography to the artist. It is also probable that the artist many times did not belong to the religion or cult, the images of which he was carving. A comparative study of Bharut, Sanchi and Amaravati sculpture can give an understanding of how each style influenced the other. In Sanchi, we see elements of both Shunga art in continuation with Bharut, as well as Satavahana from Amaravati. At Bharut, as has been seen, the typical features of sculptures, particularly the depiction of Jataka tales, are flatness of figures, simple narrative to communicate the story. The figures do not overcrowd the space available. As will be seen in the next module, sculpture from Amaravati almost overcrowd the available space and there is no negative space left. There are glimpses of all these features at Sanchi. The flatness is still there, but the sculptures are eventually gaining more volume. In some sculptures of Sanchi, for example, sculptures depicting horse riders, lions, pillar capitals depicted on railing post, some Gajalakshmi images and centaur with female rider, the flatness is more apparent. There is a unique attempt at depicting the frontal image of an elephant rider at stupa second, showing all four legs of the elephant along with its tail as well as the trunk. In the depiction of Jataka tail, the space gets more crowded and negative space is very less. As example can be Vesantara Jataka. Some sculptures are seen emerging more and more out of stone, gaining more volume and slowly leaving the flatness behind. Examples may be taken of a depiction of people indulging in water sports on the north face of the second stupa, or elephant riders on the first stupa, or the depiction of miracle at the Kashyapa Hermitage on the first stupa. In all these examples, figures are not as flat as they were in Bharut and are more deeply carved into the stone. They also look more naturalistic. The human figures, plants, birds and animals all gain more height, they look more close to their actual size and they gain more gravity. The figures are also more elongated than their Bharut counterparts. They look more grounded than the depiction of Jataka in Bharut. the overcrowdedness of the figures seen in Sanchi is not seen in Bharut. It is seen heavily in Amaravati sculpture. Sanchi therefore shows features from both the places. Greater volume and more depth can be seen even in the Yakshi images of Sanchi. They too are more deeply carved and are placed such that stone is removed from the negative space. Their limbs are seen coming out of the stone without its support in some parts of the background. An iconic depiction of Buddha continues, and human depiction is yet to emerge in Sanchi as well as in Amaravati. Sculptures at Bharut and Sanchi show religious and sometimes secular themes. Also, they are almost like sculptural documentary on the life of people at that time. We get to see houses in which common people lived, chariots which were used when a king would ride in chariots into a village, how people would come out to look at it or look at a procession. We see detailing of costumes, headgears, hairstyles and jewelry, even dancing men and women, acrobats being performed. We see people involved in everyday chorus, elephant riders, plants, birds and animals. We see musical instruments and people playing them. People from different regions and different occupational background. Even foreigners, non-Indians, local beliefs and practices of that time. We see traces of so many traditions in sculpture that emerge in the coming time across the Indian subcontinent at Sanchi, and along with this, we get a glimpse of life of this period.